Hello everyone, a very good morning to all of you. I hope I am clearly visible and audible to you people. Give me one second to confirm if I am clearly visible and audible. I will start the class ahead. Just give me 1 minute. If I am clearly visible and audible, I will start the class ahead very fast. Okay, so I hope I am clearly visible and audible to you people. So I welcome you all for today's session. I am Dr. Priyanka Sachdev here, Medical Entrance Educator on an academy. So today I am here to continue my microbiology series which I have launched for FMG students. So in microbiology we have covered general microbiology and then we have started immunity. In immunity we have started antigen antibody reactions. So yesterday we have already started antigen antibody reactions. In the first chapter we have seen what are antigens, type of antigen, complete antigen, incomplete antigen, heptans, adjuvant, everything. In the second lecture of antigen antibody, we have seen the type of antibodies, structure of antibodies, and we have started these reactions. There are 11 types of antigen antibody reactions, out of which one is already covered yesterday, that is precipitation. So today I will start with agglutination, then I will move on complement fixation, and then in the last I will move on ELISA. So these are important among these 11 on which many MCQs are asked in your previous year papers of FMG. So you should understand these 4-5 important antigen antibody reactions. So yesterday we have completed precipitation, I guess we have completed. So just in the first 1 minute or 2 minute I will revise you precipitation, the examples of precipitation, basically types of precipitation. Immediately after that I will move on in agglutination. So what was the difference between precipitation and agglutination? Yesterday only I have told you precipitation and agglutination, in both of these antigen binds with antibody, and as a result of which antigen antibody complexes are formed. But depending on the physical state of this antigen, if the antigen is soluble, it is known as precipitation, and if the antigen is solid, that is particulate means solid, it is known as agglutination. This we have discussed yesterday only. So precipitation we have already discussed. In precipitation the antigen is a soluble, it is liquid antigen, and precipitation is of two types. Yesterday only I have told you, this is the test tube, you are making antigen antibody complexes. So this is the antigen and this is the antibody. Just for say, this is the antibody. If antigen antibody complexes are present at the bottom of the test tube or they are present, they are floating at the top of the test tube. Depending on that, antigen antibody reactions are known as by two names, precipitation. Both of them are precipitation because in both of them the antigen is soluble. Here it is known as sedimentation and here it is known as flocculation. So sedimentation and flocculation are the two types of precipitation reaction. So sedimentation and flocculation are the two types of precipitation. Yesterday only we have discussed it. Okay, let me move ahead. We have discussed one more hypothesis, lattice hypothesis. In lattice hypothesis I told you how lattice is formed. The antigen is multivalent and antibody is bivalent. So when multivalent antigen binds with bivalent antibody, a big web is formed. That web is known as lattice. And because of lattice, it is physically visible with the naked eye. Then we have discussed zonal phenomenon. What is zonal phenomenon? When antibody is in axis, it is known as prozone. When antigen is in axis, it is known as postzone. And lattice is not formed in prozone. Lattice is not formed in postzone. Lattice is formed when antigen and antibody are equivalent in proportion, then only it is formed, and it is known as zone of equivalence. You can see the peak in the zone of equivalence. This we have discussed yesterday only. We have discussed, and we have discussed the types of precipitation. We have discussed the 5 types. I will not discuss the details. I will tell you the examples of each. The first was the ring type. So we take a test tube and a ring of precipitation is formed. The example were 2, Ascoli's thermoprecipitant test of Bacillus anthrax and Lansfield grouping of the streptococcus. These were the 2 examples of ring test. So ring test is done. After that we moved on slide test and tube test. In slide test we carry out the experiment on a slide, and in tube test we carry out the experiment in a test tube. So slide test and tube test, both of which the example is syphilis. But what is the example of syphilis in each of them? So here the example is VDRL test of syphilis. And here the example is Kahan test. Yes, Kahan test of syphilis. So here were 2 examples. Here both of them syphilis, but VDRL is an example of slide test. Kahan is an example of tube test. Then we move on immunodiffusion, that is diffusion in gel. Gel, that is of four types: single diffusion, double diffusion, one dimension, two dimension. So we have discussed all of them. I'm not discussing it again. I have told you only one example of the last one, that is ELIX, gel precipitation test of the diphtheria. Diphtheria is an example of this, that is immunodiffusion. So we have discussed the four types of immunodiffusion yesterday only. You can watch the recording, those who have missed the live lecture. And the last was electroimmunodiffusion. Electroimmunodiffusion, it was rocket electrophoresis. In rocket electrophoresis, the arcs are formed in the shape of a rocket. You can see, can you see here? The arcs, the precipitation arcs are formed in the shape of the rocket. And the length of the rocket is giving us the idea of the concentration of antigen in the corresponding well. These are the wells. This is known as rocket electrophoresis. And the example, there is no example of rocket electrophoresis. So in short, we have completed the five types of precipitation. That was a revision of the last lecture. So you know the examples of each of them. I hope you know. Ring test, there are two examples. What are the two examples? Ascolis test of Bacillus anthrax, lens peel technique of Streptococcus. Learn the name of the bacteria also, for which these tests are there. The second is slide test and tube test. Slide and tube, both are for syphilis. Here VDRL test, slide test, Kahan test, tube test. After that, immunodiffusion. Immunodiffusion means diphtheria is there. Diphtheria ka ELIX test, ELIX gel precipitation test. And last is electroimmunodiffusion, that is rocket, and there is no example of it. You should learn it for your MCQs. I'm moving for today's lecture. I'm starting with agglutination. I want thumbs up from each of you. That was a revision of the last lecture. What is precipitation? What are the types? Five types of precipitation. What is the example of each type? So what are the types? What is the example of each type? I would like to move on agglutination. Again, it is of five types. So agglutination, I have already explained you what is agglutination. In agglutination, we take particulate antigen. We do not take soluble antigen. We take particulate. So see here, if we are taking a soluble antigen along with antibody, it is known as precipitation. If we are taking a solid antigen, not liquid, solid one, particulate one, along with antibody, it is known as agglutination. So I am teaching you agglutination right now. So agglutination, we have seen zonal phenomenon, zone of equivalence, holds good for precipitation also, and it holds good, the same phenomenon, lattice and zonal phenomenon, it holds good for agglutination also. It is not holding good for any of other tests. So out of these 11 tests, zone phenomenon or lattice and zone phenomenon holds good for two of them only, that is precipitation and agglutination. Have you got it? So again, important MCQ. So zone phenomenon holds here also. So what is zone phenomenon? When antibodies are in axis. See, Y-shaped antibody are in axis. So this is known as prozone. And here you can see the antigen is in axis. It is known as postzone. So prozone mein antibody is in axis. Postzone mein antigen in axis. In both of them, you can see the graph. In both of them, lattice are not formed. Lattice, the peak of the lattice is formed when both are equivalent in proportion. So when antigen and antibody both are equivalent in proportion, then only zones are formed. So prozone, antibody axis, postzone, antigen axis, and zone of equivalence, both of them are proper proportion and there is a peak. So it is holding good for agglutination also. These are the five types of agglutination. You have to learn the examples. So two of them are common. Slide, precipitation may be tha, agglutination may be hai. Tube, precipitation may be tha, agglutination may be hai. Lekin wahan pe bache hue three were different, yahan pe bache hue three are different. There is no other common. So you have to learn five types of agglutination. Slide test, tube test, an example of each of them. Coombs test, antiglobulin or Coombs test, very, very five star important. Passive agglutination, reverse passive agglutination. So these are the five types. Learn the five types. I will explain you one by one along with the examples. More important is examples. Again and again and again, I am telling you, more important is examples. Let me start with the first one, slide. As the name indicated, is very easy. Slide, you perform your experiment on a slide. You all have performed it in your second trough. So that is blood grouping. You all have performed blood grouping, AB blood grouping as well as RH blood grouping. You have performed both. So what you do here, you take a slide. On slide, you take one drop of the blood and you take one drop of the anti-sera, and with the stirrer you mix both of them. Immediately within 5 minutes of mixing, you see small clots in it. These are agglutinates. agglutinate. So the process is agglutination. Why? What is the antigen here? RBC in the blood is the antigen, and RBC is a solid thing. It is not liquid. It is particulate. So RBC in the blood is antigen, and antibody is present in this anti serum. When both of them are combining, agglutinates are formed. So because the antigen is solid, particulate, which is the RBC present in the blood, that's why it is known as agglutination, not precipitation. Give me a thumbs up. I tried my best. Give me a thumbs up. So what is the example of slide test? Who will give me the example? Blood grouping and cross matching. Blood grouping mein both. ABO blood grouping also and RH blood grouping also. Everyone give me a thumbs up. That is the example of slide test. The example is crystal clear in front of you. ABO and RH. You know how to perform it. So slide test is done. It is done on a slide. Example is ABO and RH blood grouping. Example is ABO and RH blood grouping. Coming on tube test. It will be performed in tube. As the name indicates, it will be performed in tube. It was performed in slide. Now we will perform it in a tube. So that is the name is indicating how the test is performed. Slide test ko slide pe karenge. Tube test ko tube mein karenge. So let me tell you tube test. We will take number of test tubes. You can see we have taken number of test tubes. In each of them, we have put a fixed amount of antigen. A fixed amount of antigen in all of them. Just suppose one molecule or 1 ml of antigen. A fixed amount of antigen in all of them. Antibody, we are halving. We will half antibody. So in the first, one antibody, one ml, then half ml, then 1/4, 1/8, 1/16, 1/32, 1/64. Likewise, this is the antibody. This is known as serial dilution. Serial dilution. So antigen is particulate here. That's why the reaction is same as that of precipitation. Only difference, antigen is particulate. So here you can see antibody axis is there. And here you can see antigen axis is there. So in the middle test tube only, we will find agglutinates. Can you see maximum here? Agglutinates are present. So this is known as, and this is the titer, 1/64. That is the titer of the test. That is known as tube test. Everyone give me a thumbs up. That is known as tube test. So mechanism is same. That is how we are performing it in precipitation only. Examples are different. You have to learn 5 examples here. What are the 5 examples? CPSWW. So W holds good for Vidal. Second W is Weil Fallax. So WW, Vidal test for typhoid, Weil Fallax test. C is cold agglutination test. P is Paul Bonnet test. And S, what is S? Let me say Streptococcus MG test. So these are the 5 examples. So you can see the 5 examples in front of you. Everyone, please mark it. Please learn it. Make a mnemonic and learn it. Many MCQs are there. It is tube, but it is not tube precipitation. It is tube agglutination. Tube dono hota hai. And slide agglutination ka only one example is there. What is the example? Blood grouping and cross matching, ABO and RH both. What is the examples of tube? WWPCS, Vidal test, Weil Fallax test, Paul Bonnet test, cold agglutination test, Streptococcus MG test. Say it again and again, Paul Downing. Say it again and again. Let me come on another. The third one, Coombs test. Now it is a real challenge to understand Coombs test. I will try my best. Coombs test or antiglobulin test. Coombs test or antiglobulin test, it is of two types. Direct and indirect. Direct and indirect. Where we perform Coombs test? We perform Coombs test in case of wherever we are suspecting erythroblastosis fetalis. You know what is erythroblastosis fetalis? Okay, that is RH incompatibility. Okay, I will explain you. Don't worry. Listen, every one of you listen. Okay, I will draw it here. Listen, she is a mother. Listen, there is a couple. In the couple, the wife is there and the husband is there, of course. In the couple, there is a wife, there is a husband. The wife is RH negative. Whether she is A, blood group A negative or B negative or AB negative or O negative, but she is negative. And the husband is RH positive. Whether he is O, A positive, B positive, O positive or AB positive. I am not interested in ABO blood grouping. I am interested in RH blood grouping. The wife is RH negative and the husband is RH positive. They are married. So the couple conceived. The female become pregnant. The couple conceived. Now the fetus of them will be RH positive or negative. The fetus will be RH positive or negative. 50-50% chances there. Fetus can be RH positive, can be RH negative. If the fetus is RH negative, fetus is inside the mother, you know, inside the uterus of the mother. Fetus will never be inside the father, you know, physiologically. So fetus will be inside the uterus of the mother. If it is like mother only, there will be no problem. Fetus is also RH negative, there will be no problem. But if fetus is like father and he is RH positive, fetus is RH positive and present in a RH negative mother, then there will be the problem. What will be the problem there? What will be the problem there? I will draw it for you. I will draw the problem for you. So let me draw a uterus. This is the uterus of the mother. Let me draw the uterus. Inside the uterus, you can see this is the fetus. This is the fetus inside the mother, inside the uterus of the mother. Now see, this is a blood vessel. This is a blood vessel of the placenta connecting mother ka blood vessel hai, connecting the fetus and the mother. This is a placental blood vessel. And this is a blood vessel of the fetus present inside the fetus. What I have told you, fetus is Rh positive like father. So these are the RBCs of the fetus containing D antigen. D is Rh antigen. So it contains Rh antigen because he is Rh positive like father. And these are the RBCs of the mother which are D antigen negative because she is Rh negative. Have you got it? This is the scenario. Everyone give me a thumbs up. This is the scenario. Have you got it? You can see the uterus. You can see inside the uterus there is a fetus. You can see a blood vessel of a fetus. Inside the blood vessel, see the RBC of the fetus. RBC of the fetus contains D antigen. Can you see? It contains D antigen. That is Rh antigen or D antigen is present because fetus is Rh positive. See the placental blood vessel. Placental is the mother blood vessel. And see the RBCs inside it. These RBCs are Rh negative. They do not contain D antigen. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So what is the direction of blood flow? What is the direction of blood flow? Normally, what is the direction of blood flow? In the placenta, what is the direction of blood flow? Blood flow is from mother to fetus. Always, this is the direction. This is the direction. Throughout the pregnancy, this is the direction. So this Rh negative RBCs are coming inside the fetus. So you can say, ma'am, fetus will have a mixed blood flow. Some own fetus own RBC are Rh positive and the RBC which are coming from the placenta through the mother will be Rh negative. So fetus contains both type of RBCs. Okay, I will say okay, own RBC Rh positive hai, and the mother se jo aa raha hai wo Rh negative hai. There is no problem in it. Now at the time of the delivery, this fetus will come out. So there is vigorous contractions in the uterus during labor. There is vigorous contraction in the uterus. At that time, particularly at that time, for a fraction of moment, reverse blood flow takes place. Reverse blood flow means the blood flow from the fetus to the mother. So what will happen? These Rh positive RBC will be carried from mother to the fetus. That is the problem. So these RBCs will go to the mother blood. So they contains D antigen. Now this is a foreign for the mother. Now mother have never seen this D antigen. That will be the foreign for the mother. So first time mother is interacting with the D antigen, that is Rh antigen. The fetus came out. Immediately after that, the fetus, there is no harm to the first baby. This is the first pregnancy. The fetus is healthy. It will come out. Okay. What is the scenario then? What will happen now? What is the scenario now? So let me draw the uterus now. Okay. Just a second. What is the scenario now? Who will tell me what is the scenario now? So where I should draw? I will draw here. So see, this is the uterus of the mother. And this is the fetus you can see here. This is the fetus. During the second pregnancy, this is the second pregnancy fetus. What will happen now? This is the placenta. This is the placenta. And this is the blood vessel of the fetus. This is the blood vessels of the fetus. So second fetus is also Rh positive like the father. So these are the RBCs of second fetus which contain D antigen. It is Rh positive. And these are the RBCs of the mother. Mother is of course the same mother. It is Rh negative. But mother contains antibodies against D antigen which are formed during the first pregnancy. At the end of the first pregnancy, because of the first child, RBC were entering inside the mother. So that D antigen mother has formed antibodies against it. Now the RBCs which have entered that survive only for 120 days. They will die after 120 days. You know the lifespan of RBC is 120 days. But the antibodies are forever. They will sustain till the second pregnancy, third pregnancy, fourth pregnancy. So during this, what is the direction of blood flow? This is the direction of blood flow. Now there is a problem for the second pregnancy. So these antibodies are carried. These are anti-D antibodies. And mother will give antibodies to his own fetus, to her own fetus. And these antibodies will kill the RBCs of the fetus. So all the RBCs of the second child will be killed. The child will be severe anemic and child will die in utero. That is, death in uterus will occur due to severe anemia and jaundice. So this condition is known as erythroblastosis fetalis. So first pregnancy is always normal, but all subsequent pregnancies after first pregnancy, second, third, fourth, fifth. So either the child die in utero, fetus die in utero, or if the birth takes place also, child is severe anemic and jaundiced. Give me a thumbs up if you got the concept. So this whole complication takes place when the wife is Rh negative and the husband is Rh positive. So before marriage, all the couples should check their blood group. ब्लड ग्रुप में ए बी ओ से मतलब नहीं आई एम ए यू आर बी यू आर ओ नो यू आर पॉजिटिव और निगेटिव द आर एच ग्रुपिंग इज इम्पॉर्टेंट बिफोर मैरिज ए बी ओ ब्लड ग्रुपिंग इज नॉट इम्पॉर्टेंट इट इज द आर एच ब्लड ग्रुपिंग विच इज इम्पॉर्टेंट इफ द वाइफ इज आर एच निगेटिव एंड हस्बैंड इज आर एच पॉजिटिव these complication can take place so you should advise the couple okay you can get married but your first pregnancy is normal for your subsequent pregnancy you should take medical advice we can do the prevention of this we can do the prevention medically we can do the prevention but you, the couple should be known that this will happen so we should take prophylaxis before and only so that is the thing what is the treatment part I will not teach you here that is a medicine part it will be elongated lecture if I teach you the treatment also but that is the thing have you got it have you got it give me a thumbs up give me a thumbs up everyone give me a thumbs up I want thumbs up from everyone. It was a complicated thing. Then only I will tell you what is happening ahead. What is happening ahead? What is now? You will ask me, ma'am, why you are teaching Coombs test? This whole thing here. You are teaching us Coombs test. Now, what is the importance of Coombs test here? Suppose you are a doctor. I am a doctor. I am sitting in my clinic. This female is coming to me. This lady is coming to me. She is saying, doctor, I am second time pregnant. This is my second pregnancy and I am Rh negative. My blood group is A negative and my husband is B positive. My husband is positive. I am negative. And everyone, my neighbor says to me, my neighbor is a medico and she says to me, you are Rh negative. Your husband is Rh positive. So your second baby will not survive. My second baby will die. And I am pregnant right now. So can you tell me, is it true or not? And if it is true, can you make the diagnosis whether it will happen or not? And what is the treatment? So she will ask you three questions. So you will say, yes, it is true. The condition is known as erythroblastosis fetalis. If you are Rh negative and your husband is Rh positive and you have conceived the second time, it is possible that your second child will not survive. It will die in utero only. That is the condition known as erythroblastosis fetalis. So she will ask you, will it happen always? So yes, mostly it happens always, but we have to make the diagnosis. So how you will make the diagnosis? You will make the diagnosis by Coombs test. In Coombs test, you will take the blood sample out. Kiska blood sample? Mother ka ki bachche ka? You will take blood sample out. Whose blood sample? You will take both blood sample out. When you take the blood sample of mother and apply the test, it is known as indirect Coombs test. And when you take this blood sample of the child out, the fetus out, fetus ka kaise nikalenge? By doing the sonography. It is guided. So we will do the sonography. We will see on the screen. We will inject a syringe and we will suck the blood. We will take the blood. So by doing sonography, we will take the blood of the fetus out. And the test which is performed is known as direct Coombs test. So in short, Coombs test is of two types, indirect and direct. Tell me, have you got it? Have you got it? So let me tell you about direct Coombs test. If I am taking the blood sample of a baby out, what it will contain? See na, this will come out na. So, and if I take the blood sample of mother out, what it will contain? You tell me what it will contain. You only tell me. So if I take the blood sample of the fetus, what it will contain? You tell me, fetus. And if I take the blood sample of mother, what it will contain? You understood the condition, na? Fetus contains RBCs, which are Rh positive. Because fetus is Rh positive, so it contains D antigen on it. Which are Rh positive. Fetus is Rh positive like the father. And it is binded with the antibodies. These antibodies are given to this fetus by his own mother. Own mother is giving these antibodies because of the previous sibling. His sibling has generated that antibodies in the body of the mother. So mother has given. So this is the blood sample of the fetus. Any confusion? What is the blood sample of the mother? If I take the blood sample of the mother, it contains antibodies only. It contains only antibodies. It contains RBC, but RBCs are Rh negative. It is not Rh positive. It contains only antibodies. So understand the sample. This is the sample of the fetus. This is the sample of the mother. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So what I have to do while performing this test, I am a doctor. I have taken the sample of both of them. In one test tube, this is fetus test. The fetus sample. In another test tube, I am having mother sample. I will apply what test here? In fetus test tube, I will add Coombs reagent. I will add Coombs reagent. What is Coombs reagent? By the way, what is Coombs reagent? Antibody against antibody. So this is antibody. I will add antibody against antibody. So all of them will agglutinate together and I will see dot, dot, dot. Like in blood grouping, I will see dot, dot, dot. So agglutination will take place when I will add antibody against antibody, that is known as Coombs reagent. Here directly I cannot add antibodies against antibody. First, I have to add RBCs which are Rh positive, commercially available RBCs which are Rh positive to sensitize it. So first step is adding RBCs. And after adding RBCs, because it is free antibodies. Now here it was combined with the RBC directly. And after that, I will add the same thing. That is antibody against antibody Coombs reagent. So here also, after adding Coombs reagent, agglutination takes place. So agglutination takes place here also. agglutination takes place here also. The only difference, understand it, only difference here, it occurs in one step, that is Coombs reagent. I have added only Coombs reagent. Take the sample out of the fetus, add Coombs reagent, you will see agglutination. That's why it is known as direct test. Direct Coombs test, it happens in one step. And here two steps are required. What are the two steps are required? In first step, I am adding RBCs which are commercially available, which are Rh positive RBCs. And the second step, I am adding Coombs reagent. So it happens in, so I take the sample of the mother. First, I will add RBCs, and after 5 minutes, I will add the Coombs reagent. So it happens in two steps. That's why known as indirect. In both of them, if I see agglutination, I will ask the mother to abort the baby, either to abort the baby because it is going to die anyhow. Complications will happen. Or if treatment part is possible, at what stage of pregnancy she is coming to me. If treatment part is possible, I will ask for treatment. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone, give me a thumbs up. That is Coombs test. Have you got it? So that is Coombs test. Can you see RBC here? Can you see RBC on the surface of the RBC? Can you see a Rh reagent? This is Rh. Can you see this one? This is D antigen. And this is the antibody formed by the mother for this D antigen. Have you got it? Coombs test is of two types, direct and indirect. As I have told you, direct is for infant, for the fetus. Direct is for the fetus. Can you see? It occurs in one step. It is known as direct because here RBCs are already sensitized. Can you see the RBC? This is the RBC of the fetus. This is the RBC of a fetus, and it contains Rh antigen because fetus is Rh positive like father, and these are the antibodies given by the mother to the fetus via placenta. And what you are doing only one step, adding antibody against antibody, that is Coombs reagent. So only one step is required. As soon as you will add this antibody, agglutinate will form. So this is one step, give me a thumbs up. So that is direct Coombs test. So this is direct Coombs test. This is patient sample, you can see. And this is the antibody against antibody Coombs reagent. Whenever you are adding it, you will found a clump, you will found an agglutination. One step, that is direct. Direct is for fetus. Coming on indirect. Indirect is for mother. So when you take the sample of the mother out, this is the mother's sample. It contains only antibodies. So two steps are required. First, you add commercially available RBCs which are Rh positive, so that the RBCs will be sensitized. Then you add antibody against antibody in the second step. Then agglutinate will form. So this is known as indirect because it occurs in two steps and it occurs in mother. So that was the summary. Give me a thumbs up. That was the Coombs test, direct and indirect. Give me a thumbs up. So I'm done with the Coombs test. It is one of the example of agglutination. Coombs test is done in erythroblastosis fetalis. It is of two type, direct and indirect. Direct is done. Direct is done in fetus. And indirect is done in mother. Direct is known as direct because it occurs in one step. Indirect is known as indirect because it occurs in two steps. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. I want thumbs up from each of you. If you have any confusion, please write it down specifically. Coming on the fourth type, passive agglutination test. Passive. What do you mean by passive agglutination? What is the definition of agglutination? You tell me. What is the definition of agglutination? You tell me. What is the definition of agglutination? What is the difference between precipitation and agglutination? This is antigen, this is antibody, and it is forming complexes. That is antigen-antibody complexes. Yes. So when antigen is soluble, it is known as precipitation. And when antigen is particulate, it is known as agglutination. That I have already told you. Yes or no? Why I am telling you this again? Can I convert precipitation into agglutination? Yes, passively I can do. This is a soluble antigen. If I add a carrier molecule so that this soluble antigen converts into particulate antigen, so precipitation will get converted into agglutination. And such agglutination, which I am converting from precipitation by adding a carrier molecule, is known as passive agglutination. It is passive. It is not real agglutination. It is passive. Give me a thumbs up. So what I am doing, I am converting a soluble antigen into a particulate antigen. How I am converting it? By adding a solid carrier molecule. So the carrier molecule is solid, particulate. So when the soluble antigen binds with the carrier molecule, it will become particulate. The whole antigen will become particulate, and precipitation will get converted into agglutination. Give me a thumbs up, I tried my best. So by attaching a soluble antigen with a carrier molecule, it is possible to convert precipitation into agglutination. And such agglutination is known as passive agglutination. Everyone give me a thumbs up. What are the examples? So what carrier you are adding depending on that. What carrier? So this is your soluble antigen. When you are combining this soluble antigen with a carrier molecule, then what will happen? This is the carrier molecule and this is the particulate antigen on it. Now the antigen will become particulate. it is not soluble anymore, it has become particulate because it is combined with the carrier. Now depending the carrier is of two type, either the carrier is latex, so it is known as latex agglutination, or it is RBC, it is known as heme agglutination. So it is of two types, passive agglutination is of two types, latex or heme, depending what carrier you are using. If you are using latex, it is known as latex agglutination. If you are using RBC, it is known as heme agglutination. So Rose-Vellard test is the example. Okay, I will show you, just give me 1 minute. Rose-Vellard test. So Rose-Vellard test is an example of heme agglutination. So Rose-Vellard test for RA, rheumatoid arthritis, please learn it. Or latex, there are other examples you can learn if you wish. They are not important, but you can learn ASO titer, CPR, RA factor, HCG, insucker detection is an example of latex. So these are examples of passive agglutination. Give me a thumbs up. Should I come on the fifth one? The last one is reverse passive agglutination. The last one is reverse passive agglutination. Give me a thumbs up. Till now, is it okay? So again, I will explain you. This is antigen. This is antibody. When they combine, complexes are formed. Okay, we know it. We know it. So when the antigen is soluble, it is known as precipitation, we know it. And when the antigen is particulate, it is known as agglutination. So what we were doing in passive agglutination, we were converting soluble antigen into particulate antigen by combining a carrier. So it was known as passive. So precipitation was getting converted into agglutination. That was known as passive agglutination, right? If instead of converting antigen from soluble to particulate, if we convert antibody from soluble to particulate, from soluble to particulate by adding a carrier, if we are converting antibody, it is known as reverse passive agglutination. It is then also precipitation will get converted into agglutination. So it is also passive, but it is reverse passive. It is reverse passive. It is not actual passive. It is reverse passive. It is also passive. We are converting in both of them. In both of them, we are converting precipitation into agglutination by converting a soluble thing into a particulate thing. Into a particulate. The only difference is that here in passive agglutination, here soluble antigen is converted into particulate antigen, and in reverse passive, soluble antibody is getting converted into particulate antibody, both of them by adding a carrier. Everyone give me a thumbs up, I tried my best. So that is known as reverse passive. So read the definition, the antibody is absorbed on a carrier particle instead of antigen. So antibody will become particulate. So precipitation will get converted into agglutination. So this is known as reverse passive. There is no example of it. There is no example of it. Let me revise. This is the summary of agglutination. See the summary. See the examples. So I have told you 5 type of agglutination. Slide, only one example, blood grouping and cross matching. ABO blood grouping also, RH blood grouping also. The second is tube velux. The mnemonic is WWPCS. Vidal, wheel phallus, Paul Bunnett, cold agglutination, streptococcus MG test. So read the 5 names. Coombs test. Coombs test mein erythroblastosis fetalis is the example. It is of two type, direct, indirect. Direct is for fetus. Indirect is for mother. One step, two step. You know. Passive agglutination is of two type. Heme agglutination, latex agglutination. Heme mein only one example, Rose-Vellard. Latex mein many examples you can learn. And the last one here, it is not written. Reverse passive agglutination. There is no example of it, but you can enumerate the name. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Any confusion? So those who are listening, I want thumbs up from each and every of you. Each and every one of you. Each and every one. I'm waiting for your thumbs ups. So please give me a thumbs up so I will know that you understood it completely. Let me revise the table for precipitation also, then I will launch polls based on it. Precipitation is also of 5 types. Ring test, slide test and tube. So slide and tube is common for both. Immunodiffusion and electroimmunodiffusion. So ring test, we have 2 examples. Ascolis for bacillus and Lancefield for streptococcus. Slide and test, both are for syphilis. This is BDRL syphilis, this is Kahn syphilis. Immunodiffusion is Alex gel precipitation test for diphtheria. And electroimmunodiffusion, there is Rocket electrophoresis, there is no example of it. I hope you got it. So I would like to launch polls here. You have to write your answer. You have to write your answer in the chat box as fast as you can. As fast as you can. So based on the examples only, all questions will be there. See examples of agglutination. Once revise it by your own, I'm not reading it. All examples of agglutination. See the examples of precipitation. All examples are in front of you. Just revise them. Apne man mein revise karo. Then I will launch the polls. So here I am launching the polls. Okay. So this is the first question in front of you. Rose-Vellard test is. What is it? You tell me. Complement fixation test. Precipitation in gel. That is immunoprecipitation, immunodiffusion. Ring precipitation or passive heme agglutination. So what it is, you decide it. यू डिसाइडेड इट इज नॉट कॉम्प्लीमेंट फिक्सेशन, इट इज प्रेसिपिटेशन और एग्लूटिनेशन. पहले तो ये डिसाइड करो प्रेसिपिटेशन है कि एग्लूटिनेशन है, और जो भी है वो क्या है, विच टाइप इज इट, विच एग्जैक्ट टाइप पूछा है मैंने. यस मोस्ट ऑफ यू आर राइट. सो रोज वेलर टेस्ट इज यस. एनी वन एल्स? रोज वेलर टेस्ट आई कैन सी द चैट बॉक्स. सो मोस्ट ऑफ यू रिचार्ड यू आर राइट, पटेल यू ऑल आर राइट. ओके आई कांट रीड द नेम्स, इट इज अ बिग लिस्ट. ओके यू ऑल आर राइट, द करेक्ट आंसर हियर इज डी. ऑल ऑफ यू आर सेइंग इट इज अ पैसिव हीम एग्लूटिनेशन. वी आर यूजिंग आरबीसी टू कन्वर्ट a soluble antigen into a particulate antigen. So Rose Velard test is an example of that. So correct answer here is D. Very good. This is the next question in front of you. So VDRL is an example of. So decide from the options. Is it agglutination or is it flocculation? You know flocculation is a type of precipitation. You know na, precipitation was of two types, sedimentation and flocculation. So is it agglutination or is it precipitation? And is it slide tube? Now it's a confusing question. Full of confusions. Confusing question. You tell me what is the answer. You tell me. So it is a tricky question. This is how questions came in your exam. It is a simple question yet tricky, I can say. So yes, who will tell me the correct answer? No one yet. Who will tell me the correct answer? Among the audience. So first decide now whether it is agglutination or whether it is precipitation. You will say, ma'am, it is precipitation. But precipitation is not given in the options. But flocculation is given. Na? Flocculation is a type of precipitation only. So flocculation mein kaun se ka example hai? Slide ki tube. I have told you two things, slide, precipitation and tube. Slide mein example, slide ka example is BDRL and tube ka example is kahan. Those who are saying A and B, they are absolutely wrong. So dream catcher, Suyog, you are wrong. It is not agglutination, it is precipitation, first thing. Precipitation mein se decide karo slide hai ki tube hai. Precipitation, agglutination to hai nahi na. BDRL is not an example of agglutination. So the answer here is C. Precipitation is of two types, slide and tube. स्लाइड में BDRL टेस्ट फॉर सिफिलिस आता है और ट्यूब में कहान टेस्ट. बार बार मैंने याद कराया है, बोथ ऑफ देम आर फॉर सिफिलिस. सिफिलिस दिस इज स्लाइड प्रेसिपिटेशन, दिस इज ट्यूब प्रेसिपिटेशन. प्रेसिपिटेशन इज ऑल्सो नोन एज फ्लॉक्यूलेशन. प्रेसिपिटेशन इज ऑफ टू टाइप्स, सेडिमेंटेशन एंड फ्लॉक्यूलेशन. फॉर सो इंस्टेड ऑफ प्रेसिपिटेशन वी कैन यूज द टर्म फ्लॉक्यूलेशन. एवरीवन गिव मी अ थम्स अप. एवरीवन दोज हु आर रॉन्ग स्पेशली दे गिव मी द थम्स अप. द करेक्ट आंसर हियर इज सी, स्लाइड flocculation. Flocculation means precipitation. So it is an example of slide precipitation. It is not agglutination. Two options are ruled out. It is flocculation or precipitation. So slide or tube that you have. So instead of BDRL, if it contains kahan, my answer will become D. My answer will become D. Have you got it? So correct answer here is C. Give me a thumbs up, everyone. This is the next question in front of you. Which of the following is agglutination test? Read from the options and tell me. Which of the following is an agglutination test? Who will tell me? Vidal test? Vidal test, VDRL test, Ascoli's test or Kahan test? I'm asking agglutination, any agglutination, not specifically some agglutination, any of it. So yes, who will tell me the correct answer? Khushi, Dreamcatcher, Richard, Ayusha, who will tell me? Rakesh, anyone else? So who will tell me the correct answer? What is the correct answer here? So Khushi is saying A is the correct answer. Yes, Khushi, you are right. So, yes, you all are right. A is the correct answer. The correct answer here is A. BDRL is an example. Kahan is an example. Both of them are example of precipitation test. This is slide. This is tube. Ascoli's is ring precipitation. It is also precipitation ring. But Vidal test is an example of agglutination. Which type of agglutination? Which type of it is an example of tube agglutination? Tube. So, you should be specific. So, correct answer here is A. You all are right. This is the next question in front of you. Be fast. Paul Bunnett is a type of. Paul Bunnett is a type of which antigen-antibody reaction? Is it agglutination? Is it complement fixation? Is it precipitation? Or is it flocculation? Now, precipitation, flocculation is one and the same thing. Yes. You tell me what is the correct answer? It is very easy question. Very easy question. But I want to tell you, most of your MCQs in any of your exam, in your FMG also, in your previous year papers, you can see they are based on examples of these. To learn the specific example in each category. Yes, you all are right, Khushi, you are right. The correct answer here is A. It is agglutination. So which type of agglutination Paul Bunnett test is it? Is it tube agglutination? So correct answer here is A. You all are right. Very good. This is the next question in front of you. Weil-Fallix reaction is. Weil-Fallix is an example of ring test. Is it an example of ring test or tube precipitation or slide agglutination or tube agglutination? First, decide it is precipitation or agglutination. Is it precipitation? So options will be ruled out. Now, these two options are for precipitation and these two options are for agglutination. So first decide whether it is precipitation or agglutination. Then decide the type. Ring is a type of precipitation. Now we know it. Yes or no? So what will be the answer here? What will be the, yes, Wheel Ferrex is an example of agglutination. So two options are ruled out. A or B to nahi hai. Now C or D mein se decide karo. Is it slight agglutination or tube agglutination? Yes, you all are right. The answer is D. Tube agglutination has five examples. W, W, P, C, S. So Vidal, Wheel Ferrex. So Wheel Ferrex is an example of tube agglutination. So the correct answer here is D. You all are right. Very good. I'm proud of you. The correct answer here is D. Coombs test is an example of what? So all these questions are already asked in your PYQs. All these questions are already asked in PYQs. I will help you in solving PYQs of micro also of past 5 years, last 3 years. That is 5 papers I will help you in solving. So you will see all these questions there also. So Coombs test is an example of precipitation test or agglutination test or complement fixation or neutralization. It's a very easy question. BB question, I guess. So you all are right. The correct answer here will be B. It is an example of agglutination test. Agglutination is of pipe type. The fourth or third one is Coombs test. We know. So slide test, tube test, Coombs test, passive agglutination, reverse passive agglutination. These are the 5 types of agglutination. So Coombs test is an example of agglutination. Correct answer here is B. You all are right. Very good. This is the, we are done with it. We are done. So let's move ahead. We are done with precipitation. We are done with agglutination. Let me come on complement fixation test. Then I will come on ELISA. After that, I will come on ELISA. So complement fixation, I will be a little bit faster. You know what is complement? What is complement? So in human blood, complement is present. This is antigen. This is antibody against the antigen. So whenever antigen-antibody complexes are formed, whenever, please mind my words, antigen-antibody complexes are formed, then complement is also binding with this complex and a triad is formed. This triad is containing 3 things, antigen, antibody and complement. Now listen, complement cannot bind with free antigen. Complement cannot bind with free antibody. Complement can bind with antigen antibody complex. That is the property of complement. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. That is complement fixation test ka, you know, that is the principle. Now complement fixation test is used for testing antibodies, not for antigen. We test antibodies. Just suppose there is a patient in front of me. The patient is having, of course, some disease. So patient is having some disease. The patient is having some disease. This is a patient. Just suppose the patient is having fever, tonsillitis, severe throat pain. The patient is having any disease. So what I am suspecting? I'm suspecting something. Now I'm a doctor. I should suspect something. The cause of this some may be some bacteria. So if the blood, this is the blood vessel. So blood vessel contains antigen of that particular cause which is causing that disease, and blood also contains antibody against that bacteria. Body has already formed the antibody. Now if I take the blood sample out of this patient in a test tube, so it contains antigen also, it contains antibody also. It is my wish whether I want to test antigen or whether I want to test antibody. So here this test, that is complement fixation test, is for testing antibodies. I will test antibodies in the blood. I will not test antigen. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. I will test antibody. How I will test? Just suppose there are 2 patients. Now it is difficult, huh? I will try. There are 2 patients in front of me. Can you see? This is patient A and this is patient B. Can you see? Patient A and patient B. There are 2 patients in front of me. Both of them are having the same disease, just suppose fever and tonsillitis. I am suspecting Streptococcus pneumoniae. The cause of this, the Streptococcus pneumoniae of this tonsillitis, just suppose. So I'm taking the blood sample out of both of them. I'm centrifuging the blood sample. So I'm taking the serum of both of them. Centrifuging and taking the serum. So this is test tube 1 containing serum of patient A. This is test tube 2 containing serum of patient B. Both the serum externally will look yellow. Both the serums are looking. But in A, the antibodies are present. Antibodies are present. And in B, no antibodies are present. Antibodies are not present. This is some other cause. But how I will know? I don't know. Nah. I'm a doctor. I'm suspecting. Maybe I'm right. Maybe I'm wrong. So for that, I'm performing this test. So the patient B is not having any antibodies in the blood. So but how I will know? By performing this test. Apart from it, both the patients have complement. Can you see the complement? The blood contains complement, no? Complement 1, 2, 3, 4, human blood contains it. So this is natural complement in both of them. Natural complement, complement to dono mein hi hai. But patient A have antibodies also. Patient B have no antibodies. So first thing, you have to heat the sample, both the samples, so that natural complement is killed. Natural complement se confusion nahi hona hai, to kill kar do. Heating kills the complement. So you are killing natural complement so that you can add artificial complement. So natural complement is killed. So now patient A, you can see patient A contains only antibodies. and patient B serum contains nothing because the natural complement is killed. Give me a thumbs up. The third step, first step is heating. The second step, you will add antigen externally and complement externally. So you are adding it. Antigen, suspected antigen, that is Streptococcus pneumoniae commercially available, and complement, artificial complement commercially. So you are adding it in both test tubes, two things. So in the first test tube, antibodies were already there and you are adding antigen also and you are adding complement also. So triad, triplet will form. Antibody to pehle se hi thi, wo antigen se bind karke antigen antibody complex bana legi aur complement bhi usse chipak jayega. So antigen antibody complement triads are formed in patient A. But what will happen in patient B? In patient B, antibody was absent. So whenever you add antigen and complement, they will remain free only. They will not bind. Complement cannot bind with free antigen, free antibody. It bonds with complexes only. So complement and antigen both are free. Give me a thumbs up. In the third step, you are adding sheep RBC. You are adding sheep RBC in both the test tubes. Few RBCs in both of them. In the first patient, patient A, complement is not free. It is engaged in forming the triads. So complement is not free. So RBC ka hemolysis nahi hoga. In the second test tube, complement is free. It is not binded. So it will cause hemolysis of the RBC. So this sample will turn red. So whenever sample is turning red, the test is negative. And whenever sample is not turning red, it is remaining yellow only. The test is positive. It was difficult. Usually color change positive hota hai na. Yahan pe color change hona negative hai. Agar color change ho raha hai, means antigen is absent. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. I am waiting for your thumbs up. I want thumbs up from each of you. Then only I will proceed. You can see same here also. You can see here also. You can see here also. There are two samples. This is sample A and this is sample B. See the sample. Please everyone see the sample here. Can you see? This is the sample. It contains antibody. And this is the sample. It do not contains antibody. But externally looking at the test tube, in my eyes, there is no microscope. No, I can't see whether antibodies are present in this test tube or do not. This is the sample taken out of my patient. So I'm a doctor. I will perform this test. I'm a microbiologist. So first I will heat it to kill the natural complement. Then I will add two things in each of them. I will add complement and antigen. I will add complement and antigen. So here in the first test tube, triad is formed because antibody was already present and you are adding complement and antigen. In the second test tube, antibody was absent. So complement and antigen will not form the triad. So here complement is free and here complement is not free. It is engaged. It is engaged. Have you got it? In the second step, you are adding sheep's RBC in both of them. Sheep's RBC. So whenever you add sheep's RBC here complement is engaged. So it will not cause lysis of the RBC. And here complement is free. So here it will cause lysis of the RBC. So here sample turned red. So sampling turned red means it is negative serum. It do not contain antibody. And if it remains yellow only, means it is positive serum. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. So this is the steps. You can see it is written in front of you. You can see and read it. So we are done with the third also. And what is the example? Only one example. Example is important. Exam mein, university exam mein procedure puchenge. But competitive exams mein, FMG mein examples puchenge. So only one example is there. What is the name of that example? Let me tell you. Wasserman reaction is an example of CFT, complement fixation test. So the example here is Wasserman reaction. Learn it, Wasserman reaction. So till now we have done this. Till now we have done this. So see, these are the examples of precipitation. Okay. So these are the examples of agglutination. Okay. And these are the examples of CFT. Okay. So see, so learn the name of the test also. This is the name of the test, you can see. And learn the type of bacteria for which that particular test is performed. So Ascolis precipitant test is an example of ring precipitation. It is performed for Bacillus anthrax. Lensfield testing is an example of ring only, ring precipitation. It is performed for Streptococcus. Kahan and BDRL, these two are syphilis. These two are tests for syphilis. Both of them are precipitation, but Kahan is tube precipitation. VDRL is slide precipitation. One more test for syphilis in the last. That is Wasserman. Wasserman is also test for syphilis, but it is an example of complement fixation. So syphilis ke liye we have three entities. We have three things for syphilis. Syphilis. So two of them, VDRL and Kahan, are example of precipitation tube and slide respectively. And Wasserman is an example of CFT. It is in front of you. It is a full of MCQ slide. It is master slide. This slide should be included in your golden notebook, so that on the last day of your exam, few days before your exam, you can revise this slide. You can revise this table. Without that, you can't enter in the exam room. One of the question you can expect from this slide. Done. So that is the thing. You can see here. examples of agglutination. Paul Bonnet, Rose Velar. Paul Bonnet is an example of not only Paul Bonnet, Paul Bonnet, Vidal, Wheelphalex, that is WWPCS. You know, all of them are example of tube agglutination, and Rose Velar is an example of passive hemagglutination. Apart from it, Coombs test is also there, which is not given here. Here the bacteria are written for which that particular test is performed. Wheelphalex is performed for rickets. Vidal is performed for typhoid. Paul Bonnet is performed for infectious mononucleosis. Rose Velar is performed for rheumatoid arthritis. So learn the name of the bacteria also, for the agent also. That is what you want to diagnose. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. This is the master slide. So that is the master stroke. Done. That is the master stroke that should be included in your high yielding point notebook. The notebook is in front of you, I guess. Daily in my lectures, please take that notebook and write it down, whatever I'm asking you to include. I'm not asking you to include the procedure of each of them, the diagram of each of them. No, include the example of each of them in your notebook for your last day revision. So we are done with it. We are done with precipitation. We are done with agglutination. We are done with complement fixation. Now I'm coming on the last thing, ELISA. It is a difficult thing. Time is limited, so I have to be fast. So last thing is ELISA. Then this chapter is over. The important ones are covered by me in this lecture. So I'm starting with ELISA. Enzyme. What is the full form of ELISA? ELISA. Enzyme linked immunosorbent assay. ELISA. It is also known as ER. Enzyme immunosorbent assay. In short, it is known as ER. So ELISA and ER are one and the same thing. You should know the full form. Why it is known as immunosorbent? What is the meaning of immunosorbent? And why enzyme term is used? So it is based on two things. The full form of ELISA is based on immunosorbent and enzyme. We use enzymes for detecting antigen and antibodies. That is why it is known as enzyme. And why it is known as immunosorbent? Immunosorbent is an absorbing material. So we use a micro titer plate. Can you see? It is a micro titer plate containing wells, containing many wells, holes. Holes are there, wells are there. So one plate containing many holes, 200, 300 holes are there. In each hole, I will add sample of one patient. So simultaneously, I can perform multiple tests. And all these wells are coated. All these wells are coated with immunosorbent material. That immunosorbent material will absorb either the antigen or antibody on it. Give me a thumbs up. That is the thing. You can see the wells. You can see these are the wells. In which orange color you can see, that is the positive sample. The blue color is the negative sample. So you can see the color changes indicating whether it is positive or negative. So color changes there in the wells. Can you see? So we will number it according to the patient. So which patient is positive, which is negative. We can perform multiple tests together. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. It is economic. It takes only 2 to 3 hours. It is the most sensitive test. Usually we use it for HIV, for testing of HIV. It is of three types. Now this is difficult. This is again challenging. I will try my best. I will not repeat it, huh? Because time is limited. I will say it only once. The three types: sandwich ELISA, indirect ELISA, competitive ELISA. So the three diagrams are in front of you. So this is sandwich, this is indirect, this is competitive. I will explain you the three processes are in front of you. So I will explain you all three processes one by one. Don't worry. Let me start with the first one, sandwich. Then I will come on indirect, then I will come on competitive. So there are four steps in each of them. Step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4. One by one, we will discuss all of them. Four step of each of them. Let me start with sandwich. Now listen, one more thing. Sandwich. Sandwich is for antigen detection. And indirect and competitive, both of them are for antibody detection. Learn the basics. First understand the basic, then I will explain you the mechanism. Sandwich is for antigen detection. And indirect and competitive are for antibody detection. First learn it. Let me start with sandwich. So it is for antigen detection, and whatever detection it is, this I am expecting in the sample of the patient. Now just suppose this is a sample of my patient in a test tube. Now whether it contains antigen, it contains antigen of HIV also, it contains antibody for HIV also. It is my wish what I want to test. So it contains both, sample contains both. Yes, it is a HIV patient, so it contains antigen also, antibody. If antigen is present, then only antibody is present. If antigen is absent, antibody will also absent. Yes or no? So body will form antibody only if antigen is present. So sample contains both things, for the bacteria, for the virus, antigen also, antibody also. So sandwich is used for antigen detection. Indirect and competitive are used for antibody detection. That is the first thing. So this is my sample. This is my sample. So before putting sample, this is a well. You see, this is a well of the micro titer plate. This is one of the well of. So I will put my sample in the well. I will put my sample in the well. So whatever I want to detect. So as I have told you, in sandwich, I want to detect antigen. So before that, I will coat the well with antibody. Opposite se start karenge. I will coat the well with antibody. And here in both of them, indirect and competitive, in the sample, I want to test the antibody. So I will coat the well with antigen previously before putting the sample. I tried hard. Okay. Let me start with the first one. I will tell you four steps of each of them. So this is for antigen detection sandwich one. So antigen detection ke liye, what are the four steps? Listen the four steps. See the sandwich wala. In the diagram only, I will tell you all four steps. So this is your sample. This is my patient. My patient, I'm suspecting HIV in the patient. So I asked the history also. I'm highly suspecting the patient is having HIV. So I took the blood sample of the patient. So this is the antigen present in the blood. This is the antigen present in the blood. And this is the antibody present in the blood. Sample contains both antigen and antibody. But for sandwich ELISA, it is for antigen detection. I want to detect the antigen. I want to detect antigen here. I don't want to detect antibody. So what I will do, I will take a microtiter well. This is one of my well on the plate. You know, plate have hundreds of well. This is one of the well. Before putting my sample in this well, I will put the sample in second step. In the first step, I will coat the well with antibody. Antibody against HIV that is commercially available. That I have coated the well. That I have coated the well with antibody. Then that is first step. In the first step, I have taken the antibody. Then in the second step, I will put my sample. This sample, the test tube of the patient. I will put my sample here. Now there are two possibilities. The sample can have antigen, cannot have antigen. That is why I am doing this test now, whether it is having HIV or do not having HIV. So just suppose the patient is having antigen. So that antigen will bind with the antibody. Can you see? This is the antigen. It is binding with the antibody which is previously coated on the well. Give me a thumbs up. So antigen antibody complexes are formed. After every step, I will wash it. So I will wash it. So if the complexes are formed, it will not go away. If complexes are not formed, you imagine a situation when antigen is not present. So it will be washed away in the washing step. At every step, we have to wash it. So that is second step. Give me a thumbs up. At the third step, I will again add antibody. So in the first step, I have added antibody. That antibody is against HIV, normal antibody against HIV antigen or whatever antigen I want to detect in the sample. Second step is sample addition. In the sample, antigen is present or may not present. In the third step, again, I am adding a commercially available antibody. See this antibody. Now you will say, ma'am, what is the difference of this antibody and the first antibody you were adding? The first antibody that was coated, that was a normal antibody. And this antibody contains enzyme in it. In the tail of the antibody, there is an enzyme. I will tell you the name of enzyme later on. But this is the antibody containing enzyme in the tail. It is a special antibody against HIV only. This is antibody. And in the fourth step, again, I will wash it. And in the fourth and the last step, I will add the substrate to this. I will add the substrate to this enzyme. If the sample in the second step, the sample contain antigen, then this complex is formed. In the third step, if this complex is formed, then this is the antigen in the center, on both sides of which antibodies are there. This is normal antibody in the first step and this is enzyme wala antibody in the third step. So a sandwich is formed. In the center, there is an antigen, both sides antibodies. So sandwich is formed. That's why known as sandwich ELISA. The first antibody is normal. The second antibody is the enzyme containing antibody. And if antigen is absent, it will be washed away. In the fourth step, when we add the substrate, if enzyme wala antibody is present, then only substrate will give color change. If color change is there, means it is positive. The sample contains the antigen. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone give me a thumbs up. I tried hard. So what are the four steps? Have you got it? Should I repeat or have you got it? So I am having two samples. I am repeating it. I am having two samples of two patients. Both of them I am suspecting. I am suspecting HIV in both of them. The first sample is actually HIV positive. He is having antigen. The second patient, patient B, is not having HIV antigen. I am suspecting I am wrong. So how I will know? I will perform sandwich ELISA in both of them. So what I will do? I will take a microtiter plate for both of them. This is my microtiter plate. I will take antibody. Initially, I will coat with commercially available antibody. That is the first step. In the second step, I will put the sample. Sample here also. So in the second step, here antigen is present. So it will bind with the antibody. Here antigen hai nahi. So how antigen will bind? Here no antigen will bind, no antigen. So I will wash. So yahan pe washing mein nahi jayega, yahan pe washing mein sab nikal jayega kyunki antigen hai nahi. In the third step, I will again add antibody which contains enzyme on its tail. So in the third step, let me draw antibody, another antibody which contains enzyme. So here sandwich is formed because antigen pehle se tha, yahan pe to antigen hai nahi. So this antibody will come here, but complex is not formed because antigen is missing. So that's why it will be washed away. In the washing step, it will be washed away because complex is not formed because antigen is missing. And in the fourth step, last step, fourth step, I will add the substrate in both of them. I will add the substrate in both of them. So here, when I will add the substrate, the enzyme is present. Enzyme will convert substrate into product and color change will be there. And here, whenever I will add the substrate, kyunki enzyme hai nahi, kyunki enzyme wala antibody is washed away. There is no enzyme, so no color change. So if color change is present, it is positive. If color change is absent, it is negative. So it is visible in the color of the well. Give me a thumbs up. So that is sandwich. And why it is known as sandwich? Because the sandwich is formed. Antigen in the center and two antibodies at the two sides. So sandwich, two breads with the butter in between. So that is a sandwich. Give me a thumbs up if you got sandwich ELISA. So that is for antigen detection. And we can see the color change with spectrophotometer. At every step we wash. Washing is essential at every step. Give me a thumbs up. The second is indirect ELISA and competitive ELISA, but time is limited. Okay. Indirect is for antibody detection. Antibodies. So we will do the reverse. See the indirect wala. See indirect wala. There are four steps. Number one step, you take the well. The cover the well with antigen now. In the previous, we were starting with antibody. Here we are starting. Cover the well with commercially available HIV antigen. Then add your sample. Patient sample. Patient sample contain antibody. Imagine a patient sample which contain. Now it can contain, it cannot contain. If it contains antibody, it will form complex with the antigen. It is forming complexes with the antigen. And in the third step, again add antibody. Here we are adding sample. The third step, antibody containing enzymes. So antibody against antibody. Here we are adding antibodies against antibodies which contains enzyme. And in the fourth step, we are adding the substrate. So if color change occurs, it is positive. If color, no color change occurs, it is negative. Give me a thumbs up. That is for antibody detection. And the third and the last is competitive ELISA. Again, it is for antibody detection. You will ask, ma'am, two. Why two are for antibody detection? This indirect is also for antibody. This is, you said it is for antigen. We got it. These two are for antibody, What is the difference between the two? I will try. It is hard. When I was in second prof, now frankly speaking, I don't understand all these things. But now I can understand it with much, much clarity when I perform these tests on the lab. So I perform these, I have seen how to perform all these tests in the lab and I know the principle of each of them so I can understand it well. So go to your labs in your college and see how it is performed in the microbiology lab, in HIV labs. So you will have a better understanding then. So in competitive, again it is for antibody, so we will start with antigen. Take a microtiter well, cover it with commercially available HIV antigen. This is commercially available HIV antigen. Add sample. The second step is add sample. This is the patient sample. If the patient sample contain antibody, it will bind with the antibody and no free antigen will be there. All the antigen will be bind by the sample antibody in it. Then in the third step, add, don't add antibody against antibody. In this, you are adding antibody against antibody containing enzyme. Here you add antibodies against HIV antigen only. It is with enzyme, but antibody against. So there is a competition between these two antibodies. So these are the antibodies without enzyme. These are the antibodies with enzyme. So if antibodies without enzyme added in the second step, there will be no free antigen. So these antibodies cannot combine. And when you add substrate, no color change will take place. Here, no color change is positive. In the first two, color change is positivity. And here, no color change is positivity. If color changes occurs, it is negative. So I tried hard. It was a difficult thing, but I tried at the best from the bottom of my heart. So I had to stop here. These are the name of the enzymes. At every step, we are using enzymes. And these are the name of the substrate for that enzyme. So you have to learn it. I'm a little bit fast because the time is limited. So thank you very much. I have to stop here. I really enjoyed teaching you. Just after 5 minutes, I'm having another lecture. On antimicrobials. Don't dare to miss it, huh? Antimicrobials and pharmacology. Yesterday only we have started this series and today I will continue it. Antimicrobials in pharmacology. So don't dare to miss it at 10:15 sharp on YouTube only. It is a free lecture. Please join me. Join the link of antimicrobials episode number 2. So today is episode number 2. Please join that. I'm ending this lecture. And from tomorrow in microbiology, I'm starting virology. So general virology. So general virology, then DNA viruses, then RNA viruses. So I will go in this sequence only. For FNG students, I will complete virology in the next 3-4 lectures, I guess. So I'm starting now after 5 minutes at 10:15 sharp. I'm starting with antimicrobial drugs. I'm ending this lecture. Bye-bye.